morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the Corner Church this morning. My name is Kim Kasaba. I'm a member of our board, and I'm here to share our announcements today. This Sunday, October 31st, Pastor Tyler Lane will be giving the sermon. And next Sunday, November 7th, Pastor Mark McAllister will be sharing a sermon and also doing communion for us. Just a reminder, we do have our Wednesday evening prayer time at 7 and Bible study at 8. You can find the link for both of these events in the Corner Connection, and they are available to join online. On November 13th, we are looking for volunteers to help deliver some postcards with info about the Corner Church to our neighbors in the area. They will be meeting at the church at 1 o'clock. If you're able to help out, it would be a great chance to come and fellowship and have a visit. Please contact Susan Jobs and let her know. We are also looking for one or two volunteers to help train on Sunday mornings to help out with the PowerPoint and the sound. We want to give a big thank you to Jason, who's been doing this ministry on his own, and we would just like to have some support for him in this area. On November 14th, we are wanting to open the church to full capacity. In order to do this, we've decided to mandate that we must request proof of vaccination for people attending the services. This doesn't apply to children under 12. They're welcome to come because they are unable to get vaccinated. If you want to see any other info or updates, check for your Corner Connection on Thursdays in your email. If anyone has pastoral care concerns, please call myself or Rona Printhapaul. We would just ask that you continue to keep the board and the ministry leaders in your prayers. We are still looking at the possibility of having an interim pastor come to help out during our transition, so please be in prayer about that. The pastoral search team is continuing to meet. We have prepared a survey that we are hoping to send out in the next few days to the congregation. Please watch your emails for that. We are really encouraging everyone to participate in this. Your input is very valuable at this time to help us in our pastoral search. So just please take a few minutes and complete the survey. If you have any questions about it when you get it or you don't receive it, we'll announce when it goes out, but you can call myself or Sandy Campbell. Please continue to pray for wisdom and discernment as we go through this process. Also pray for a clear sense of direction and for unity for all of us. Thank you. Have a great day.
Well, good morning, Corner Church. Happy Sunday to you. I hope you've had a good week. And it's good to have you with us for this morning's worship service. Some of us have had great weeks. Some of us have had challenging weeks. We need to remember that whenever we come together like this, that we all come from different lives and we all come from different challenges. And the important thing this morning is that we're together here in this moment with the same purpose, which is to hear from God and to praise Him for being in our lives. And so whether you've had a great week or a challenging week, I do invite you now to worship with us. We're going to worship through song, through giving, and through listening to His word this morning. Let's begin by worshiping using the song, Blessed Be Your Name.
Streams of abundance flow. sun shining down on me, when the world is all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out of, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name.
Well, we are always grateful for all of the ways that God's people in this church, the Corner Church, have come together to support the ministries that we have here. We're always appreciative of the people who give regularly so that the church can continue its ministry. And so let's just stop here for just a moment to give a prayer of thanksgiving to God for all of the gifts that He's continued to bring into His work here. Father, we recognize that this work that we're doing is Your work, and we trust, Lord, that as we follow the things that You ask us to do, that You will provide what we need in order to make that happen. And indeed, we see that happening. We thank You, Lord, for just the generous spirits that You've put in us to work together in community to make sure that the work You have left for us to do can get done. And we thank You now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Corner Church. Today's reading is Psalm 146. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow. but he frustrates the ways of the wicked. The Lord reigns forever. Your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Wendy, for reading that scripture for us this morning. In just a moment, Jim is going to come and lead us in a time of prayer together as a church family. And so we have an opportunity to unite our hearts and minds as we come together in a time of prayer. Prayer for the church, for the needs that we have here, the ministries that God has given us to participate in, and for those people that our church reaches. So over this next song, just know that we're going to be going into a time of prayer, and prepare yourself to humble your heart before him, but also be expectant. Also know that when we pray to him, he does reply, and be ready to listen. So as we do prepare for that time, we're going to sing, Is He Worthy?
Is anyone able to break? Greetings to the Corner Church. This is my first time doing this, and I'm maybe a little bit nervous, but I'm excited about leading us in our congregational prayer. To those that I haven't seen in a long time, it's exciting to be connecting with you in this way. And to those I have seen, it's been nice meeting you. God has been with me in my life. I just feel so blessed and exciting what is happening. And it's good to be here serving in the Corner Church in this way. So I just ask that you would just completely humble yourself as we go into our congregational prayer time and bring things to the Lord and just be at peace and agree with God and the Holy Spirit we work in. Let's humble our hearts and pray to God now. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we just recognize who you are, Father, that you are the creator of all, the creator of light and darkness, Father, the creator of hope and salvation, Father, and we are just blessed to know that. And I just feel that we need to really recognize, Lord, that you are around us, that when we talk to you, we are talking to the only true God, and that anything that distracts us, that we just need to remove that from our life, Lord, and that your love endures forever, Lord. All the things that you did in all your creation, your love endures forever. In Psalm 36, it mentions it 26 times about the things you did, Father, that your love endures forever. And I thank you to now, this day and age, that your love endures within us and endures in the Corner Church. And we are just blessed knowing that your Holy Spirit, as long as we allow you, Father, will be guiding to this church. So humble us, Father, in every way. Father, where we have separated ourselves from you, where we have sinned in different ways, whether it be small or big, Father, we ask for forgiveness. For Father, you understand you created us, and we do mess up in ways. So we just ask for forgiveness and that you would make us pure in your sight. And thank you for the gift of forgiveness and the grace that you give to us completely, Lord. Father, we are truly grateful for how you've been carrying us through these times, the difficult, challenging times, Father. So many controversial things that are going on, Father, and Christians seeing things differently, Lord, and it does make it challenging. So we thank you for being there with us and help us to bridge these things and to conquer these things, Lord. Father, we just pray for all the needs of our church. Of course, we pray for health needs, Lord. We pray for all these things in health and finances and stuff, because we believe that you will answer them, that you will care for those who are in great need of physical needs. Father, we think of those who have had surgery recently, Father, that you would comfort them, give them peace. Think of those who have uncertain health concerns where they're just not sure what's going to happen, or they may need to make a decision about surgeries or medical things that are difficult. So we just pray that you would give them the comfort to make them, Father, as you have encouraged medical people and staff to come a long way in looking after our physical bodies. And just, I'm grateful for the many things that I've had done and be able to make my life a lot better through physical healing. Finances, Father, this can really wear down on us as it's difficult. But Father, we can be at peace no matter if we have plenty or we want. And those that are going through the difficult times without things, I just pray, Father, that they would feel your strength guiding them and providing for them, and that they would be obedient to you, Father, and that you would always provide the food and the shelter and the tangible things that are very important to each one of us that we need, Father. Lord, for broken relationships, and this happens quite frequently, and it's challenging to those, and sometimes it's surprising and difficult, but Father, we think differently in many ways, and we do clash on things, and hurts come, and words are said, and Father, we need to work on these things. As we heard a sermon recently, Father, about loving each other, working as a team, and the body working together, and we have to be humble and forgiving and understanding. So those who are really struggling today that may have a broken relationships, I pray that you wouldn't make them feel guilty, but you would convict them in your way. Your Holy Spirit would help them to have strength to approach a brother and sister that they may need to deal with it and work through it. And may they feel the strength of you guiding them and encourage them. And Father, I know they would feel better and blessed because they would do these things. And of course, as I mentioned, the uncertainty, Father, as COVID has taken a toll on many people, we've all dealt with it differently, and it's been challenging. And there's so many conflicting areas, you know, how to look after it, what to do and what not to do. And these things are real there, Father, and they cause difficulties in us. Even in the reopening of our church, Lord, it's put a lot of pressure on our board. And I just pray for our board, as I know they met earlier this week and trying to decide what is best for the Corner Church. And I just pray that things are working out there, and whatever decisions they come up with, Lord, that we would do the right thing and we would reconnect through live services, Father, and that could be applicable to everybody, that nobody would feel left out. But Father, we're here to look after one another, care for one another, and in no way would we want to put someone out. So be with the board as they've been working on this and then trying to work out the wrinkles of this. This is very important in the life of our church. I believe being separated and disconnected has been challenging on us. But Father, you are there, seeing us through. There are many blessings happening, and it's exciting to know that you're still in work, but we look forward to the time that we can freely worship together and connect together, embrace each other, Father, and pray in more close quarters together at the altar, Lord. Help us. Help us to get those days back, and they will be in time. Continue on being with us there. Father, it's exciting to be on the Pastor Search Committee. And Father, there are seven of us there that are committed ourselves to doing so. Lord, we are unified so far. We've met three times. We are making progress. And I just pray that the congregation be assured that we have a plan, Father, and that we are working on it. And we are trusting in you that the timeline would come from you. Of course, we would love a pastor here as soon as possible, Father. But help us to fulfill what needs to be done for preparation for this. And I just pray, Father, that the right person would come, the person that is needed, Father, to fulfill the vacancy that we have, that we again can work with the pastor, support each other, the board and the pastor can work together. And I just pray, Lord, that your will would truly be done. So as the team meets, Father, and as we start interviewing, Father, just give us that true discernment so that we wouldn't drag things out. And when you speak, Father, and when you show us who the person is, that may we not continue searching. May we just be open to know what the plan is and who the person is. Just as Jehoshaphat, Father, was shown to go fight an army that he had no business winning, Father. And when he got the message that you were going to guide him, he didn't look for another plan, Father. He trusted you, and he didn't have to lift a single sword, and that the enemy was defeated by beating themselves up, Father. So help us to have that kind of faith and to trust in you, that you will see us through these difficult times and challenging times of finding the right pastor for us, Lord. And again, I pray for the pastor that is seeking employment, Father, that you would call them to the Corner Church, and it just wouldn't be someone to fill a position, that we would leave this position vacant until you send us this servant to serve in this area, Father. Lord, I just continue on praying for our community, as I know we have many people in our church that care about the community, want to be involved in the community, and not just for the socials, but to show God to them, Father. That is the number one thing that we as a congregation is to show God who you really are, to show them experience that we have of you in our hearts, of you helping us in difficult times when we are hurt and broken, and as few of our family members have experienced a loss of life in their own families, Father, and they need the peace of that. And may they be strong as they conquer this. And may their witness be out there so that when others see that through the most difficult time of loss of a family life, Father, you are there guiding us. And may that just flow and be released into our community, that our words and our actions are right there and guiding and directing everything that is best for our community, Father. And of course, any in things we need to do with our own hearts, Father, may we all also take gut checks within ourselves. May we just look to your words. May we constantly, Father, feed on your word, your biblical word. May we take it as the truth, and may we just read it regular, and may we take advantage of the most important thing is prayer, Father. And my prayer is that when we get back open, Father, that everybody would have a ministry to do within the congregation, Father, that you would call them, they would know what their role is, and they would do what theirs is, Father. And if those who are seeking and want to be in the church but just not sure what to do and what is the answer, Father, we have the answer, and that is spending time in prayer. Whether we spend time in prayer, corporate prayer at this time, or the midweek prayer time, or grabbing somebody else, but if you don't have the answer, God will show an answer through prayer. And I just pray that that would be another main focus, Father. I believe we have prayer warriors, and I thank you for them constantly, Father, and consistently and faithfully praying to you on behalf of the church, and bless them. And just may our prayer times grow, Father, and may we recognize the importance of it. And Father, in this world, like churches are struggling, there are difficulties, there are many issues that do separate us. And Father, it's not the issues that really bother me. It's the Christians dividing. And that is the work of Satan, Father. So when we get to difficult situations where there is clashes, may we do your will. May we know what yours is. So not that we compromise on these issues, but we do what you have called us to do and be obedient there. Lord, it is just a blessing to serve you. I thank you for the service of those in the past, and I especially think of Pastor Jackie and Pastor Dale and his family as they have moved on and answered the call to other things. I want to just say again, thank you for the service they've done in the ministries here. And as they are starting up new ministries, and Father, just bless them. May they enter with confidence and peace and direction from you, and you would just watch over them and direct them to the fullest, and may they lead their congregations and flocks the way that you would have them. Lord, we are a blessed people. We have plenty, and there is so little want and needs that we want, Father, but you provide, and I am grateful of that. So as we come to conclusion, Father, in our prayer time, just may we go with peace and the grace that you give to us, Father. You give us plentiful grace. You do not bring full judgment on us, as in Bible times you wiped out whole families and their flocks and everything, but we are under grace, and I'm so grateful for that. Just may we realize that and spend time asking for forgiveness where we failed you. May we look forward to a great week, and Father, just bless us through this week. And as we're about to hear a sermon by a good friend, Pastor Tyler, Father, just continue on blessing the words that he brings to us, Father. And may we again receive them, Father. May we absorb them. And there's been so many messages that I've heard this fall that have spoke to me, and I've spoke to the Corner Church and what we need to do. And Father, I thank you for them. I can't go into them now, but Father, there's just so many messages that the preaching team has given to it, and where we need to be. As the Christian are struggling these days, and we need to defeat Satan, and with God's grace, we will continue to defeat Satan, because he is defeated. He just only gains anything that we give to him. May we close those doors. May the division be gone, so that he is not allowed to walk through the front doors of our church, but may he realize there is no room for him here, and that he is defeated. And Father, just thank you for that. Thank you for the grace again. Bless us completely, for it's in your matchless name that I pray, and give you the glory that you deserve. Amen.
Well, good morning. My name is Pastor Tyler, if we haven't met before, and I'm here this morning with greetings from Trolls Road Church, just like Pastor Joan, who was here last week. And like Pastor Joan, I'm very blessed to have the opportunity to share with you this morning. And so I would like to take this opportunity to thank all of you, and especially thanks to your board for inviting me and Pastor Joan to share with you over these past couple of weeks. As we were talking about what we would do, and as many of you are already aware, Pastor Joan and I thought it might be fun to work together and bring a bit of a two-part mini-series as we came to visit here at the Corner Church. And we wanted to look at sidekicks in the Bible. And so last week, Pastor Joan shared with us about Elsie, the name she affectionately gave to Naaman's wife's maidservant. Now, as this is only a two-part series, and there's a lot of stories in Scripture that have sidekicks to be found, I'd very much encourage you, if you have the time, to take a look through the pages of Scripture and see what other sidekick stories you can find and what you can glean from them. Today, we're going to look all the way back into the book of Exodus and explore the role of Aaron as he found himself an unexpected sidekick to his younger brother, Moses, who had been called to lead God's people out of Egypt and into the land that God had promised them. In contrast to Elsie, who we heard about last week, Aaron's a little bit more well-known, to most of us anyway, and he has a pretty significant place in Scripture alongside Moses. Another contrast that'll be evident as we unpack this today will be Aaron's effectiveness in his role as a sidekick to Moses. Aaron has his moments, but then Aaron has his moments. This morning we're going to look at one specific moment in Aaron's role as a sidekick. It's a moment where Aaron makes a rather unwise decision. Specifically, we're going to look at Exodus chapter 32. And so if you want to turn your Bibles there, you can. And you can follow along as we unpack that when we get there. But before we get there, there's kind of a lot of story that gets us to that point. And I want to cover that ground really fast. And it's kind of hard to talk about a sidekick without talking about the main character. And so we kind of need to do that. And I want to do it as briefly as we can. Exodus is an account that largely focuses on Moses, his relationship with God, and his struggle to obey the Lord and to lead a people who never seem to get it. Because of some remarkable circumstances that we don't have time to unpack this morning, some of you will know, but these two brothers have extremely different upbringings. Aaron grows up as a Hebrew among his people. And Moses, he grows up in the household of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. And it's not until he's 40 years old that Moses finds himself on the run from Egypt and returns to his own people and is reunited with his own brother, Aaron. For the next 40 years, Moses lives as a Hebrew and lives the life of a shepherd. It's not until Moses is about 80 and Aaron is about 83. Think about that. When they're in their 80s, God shows up in a bush that doesn't burn up, and he speaks to Moses about confronting Pharaoh. Moses resists this call on several grounds, each of which God completely addresses. And so, because of that, Moses points to his own weaknesses. Moses is not a great speaker, and he says of himself that he's slow of speech and tongue. Moses actually has the audacity to try to shut all of this down. And he's brave enough to say to God, please send someone else. And it's here, interestingly, that Aaron receives his new role as sidekick. God tells Moses, fine, Aaron, your brother, will speak on your behalf. God will direct Moses, and then Moses will instruct Aaron what to say as they confront Pharaoh. I'm not sure that I would be excited about this new role if I were in Aaron's shoes, if I'm being honest. But Aaron's obedient and does what he's called to do, which is honestly more than we could say for Moses at this point. What follows is a series of incredible events, 10 encounters with Pharaoh, the 10 plagues, where God's power and authority are demonstrated to the people and to the Egyptian king. Moses, Aaron, and the people then escape Egypt, pursued by Pharaoh's army, and God parts the sea, and they cross on dry land. witnessing the destruction of the Egyptian army as the sea crashes in over them. And from here, God leads Moses, Aaron, and the people, and they follow. Eventually, God provides them with food, manna from heaven, when they aren't able to find food in the wilderness. God brings water from a rock. When they arrive at Mount Sinai, God calls Moses and Aaron to come up the mountain, and God gives the Ten Commandments to Moses and to the people. These are God's instructions for how he wants his people to live. And at this point, after all of those things, those incredible miracles we've just described, seems like it would be good to follow God's instructions. Now, Aaron has been Moses' sidekick through all of these incredible events. Over the past 40 plus years since he and Moses have been reunited, it would be easy to imagine that these two men grew close and that they knew each other well. God again calls Moses, and he tells him to bring Aaron, another fellow named Hur, and 70 elders up the mountain to worship at a distance. And from there, he calls Moses closer so that he can provide stone tablets with the commandments on them for the people. God calls on Moses to leave the rest of the elders and the leaders and come up the mountain on his own, and the rest are to stay put. So Scripture says that Moses then takes Joshua, his aide, and went up the mountain to meet with the Lord. Moses leaves Aaron in charge with Hur and tells the people that if there's any dispute to be resolved, Aaron and Hur will be there to deal with it. Well, that's interesting. Moses takes Joshua as his aide. Has Aaron been demoted? In the spirit of our sidekick series, has the dynamic duo been dissolved? Tune in next time to find out. I'm kidding. Moses may be used to having Aaron at his side, but Aaron's really looking like the best choice, as is often the case with a sidekick, to look after things in Moses' absence. It's not clear in the text, but it looks to me, at least, like maybe what's happening here is after all they've been through, Moses sees Aaron as the one he trusts to look after things while he's away. And Moses leaves very simple, clear instructions. Wait here. That's it. Don't do anything until I get back. Aaron and Hur will be here. If there's any decisions to be made, that's it. Don't do anything. And off goes Moses with Joshua up the mountain into the presence of the Lord and out of sight from everyone else. And right after that, what happens in Exodus are 7 full chapters of very, very specific instructions about worship, sacrifice, the tabernacle, and even a chapter about how Aaron will be consecrated and ordained as priest. And his sons and offspring after them will be priests for God's people. This is a high, high honor. At the same time, back in the Israelite camp, things are beginning to unravel. And this is right about where we're going to pick things up in chapter 32. You see, the funny thing about us human beings is that if you leave us alone for very long, we can start to forget things. And our desires, our fears, our insecurities, they start to run rampant. We get hungry, frustrated, at least I do. And our vision begins to narrow. Suddenly, we can only see what's right in front of us. And we start to make decisions for ourselves. So right at the beginning of Exodus 32, we see this happening, and it gets out of control fast. So you can turn there now. And I just want to read Exodus 32, just the first chapter, and then we're going to walk through the rest. It says, "When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, 'Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt,'" see, they still remember what he did, "'we don't know what's happened to him.'" They've already given up on him. They've decided Moses has taken too long, and so they go to Aaron, the sidekick. It seems they've decided that Moses is either gone, dead, or bailed on them. It doesn't matter. He was the one who had access to God, and now he's nowhere to be found. So what to do? Seems they feel that with Moses gone, God's gone too. They have no home. They're in the wilderness. They have no idea what to do now. So they go to Aaron. Now, there's a lot of things in the Exodus account and in the story of God's people as a whole that ought to sound familiar. Often as I read about the people of God, it's kind of like a mirror into my own self. And this can be comforting at times. And it can also be convicting at times. I feel like today is one of those convicting days. As we take a look at what's about to happen here, take note of those things that sound familiar or maybe ring true. The people came to Aaron because Aaron was left in charge. That makes sense. But from where I'm sitting, it doesn't really look like Aaron is the one leading. I mean, you could easily argue from what's about to unfold that Aaron's being led by the people. The Israelites are in a scary place. Up until now, God has been leading them, and Moses has been in pretty constant contact with God. So there was some clarity in a sense that while everything was fluid and changing, God was with them. But fear is a powerful motivator. And right now, they need something, anything to hold on to. And Aaron knows it. He needs to do something. At least, that's how it feels to Aaron. And so, you're going to have to permit me a little bit of speculation here. I imagine, like any good sidekick, Aaron's asking himself, okay, what would Moses do? He's dealt with the grumbling of these people before. Not a bad question, actually. But the answer he arrives at isn't great. Because Aaron tells the people to give him all of their gold jewelry, and he melted it down, and he made it into a golden calf. And then he built an altar in front of it. The people, seeing what Aaron had made, said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you out of Egypt." This is not good. Not only have the people already given up on Moses, and worse, the Lord, but they've only just received the commandments, and they're already breaking them, denying God and worshiping an idol. That didn't take long. Now, of course, God's been aware of what's unfolding down the mountain the whole time, and he tells Moses, and Moses heads back down to the people. As Moses and Joshua get closer to the camp, they hear the noise of the people. And Moses starts to see for himself what he had hoped wasn't true. Moses is furious. He tosses down the tablets that God had just given him with the commandments on them, and they smash. Moses is so angry that he takes that calf that they made out of their gold jewelry, and he grinds it into gold dust, mixes it with water, and makes all the people drink it. He's not impressed. And then he turns to Aaron, his sidekick. And I can only imagine what he's thinking. Moses has got to be thinking, you had one job. Stay here and do nothing. Just wait for me to come back. And you blew it. And so he asks Aaron, "Aaron, what did these people do to you that led them into such great sin? Sorry, that you led them into such great sin." And here we see Aaron's undoing. Moses, trying to make sense of what happened, figures the people must have forced Aaron into this, and Aaron runs with it. In a reply that should remind us a little bit of Adam in the garden, Aaron says, "You know how prone these people are to evil." And he proceeds to update the story, telling Moses that it was the people who asked him to make the calf from their jewelry. Even better, he tells Moses that all he did was throw the gold into the fire, and out pops this calf. In my experience, this is such a common instinct that we all have, that we've even kind of found ways to laugh about it today. Because I think we all understand that urge to direct fault away from ourselves. Even when it's clearly ridiculous. And as I said, this sounds a little bit like Adam in the garden trying to absolve himself from guilt when he tells God that it was Eve that made him eat the fruit. Aaron's really made a mess here. He's been with Moses more than 40 years. Aaron knows what God can do. He knows that Moses has a unique relationship with God and that God has always been faithful, never once letting the people be destroyed, even when they grumble and complain all the time. Yet with all that Aaron has seen and heard, everything he's been through, in a split second, while genuinely trying to do the right thing and to do what he was tasked with, well, he's made a big mess of it. Moses is furious. The people have fallen into sin and idolatry. Aaron, the one who's destined to be a priest, the first of the Levites, who would be set apart for the Lord on behalf of Israel, Aaron has blown it big time. Can you imagine how Aaron must feel right now? One admittedly foolish choice under pressure, and it seems all is lost. It's easy to be hard on Aaron. This is a big deal. This one action is going to have huge and tragic consequences. Our choices and actions always do. God loves us enough to discipline us and to guide us back to his will. And God does just that here, and it's not pretty. Now, we're not going to go there right now. You can read that if you like. But what I want us to see here is that God loves Aaron. God still has a plan and a purpose for Aaron's life and his future. God is angry, sure. Discipline will follow, absolutely. Aaron leading the people into idolatry will have repercussions that will carry on long into the future. And the thing is, Aaron's story is not unique. As we look at Scripture, as we look at other sidekicks in the Bible, perhaps, or other heroes that they walked with, I can see patterns that keep repeating over and over. Over and over, we read about how God's people, they seek to obey and to follow the Lord. And then over and over, they're found lacking right at the time when they should have been at the top of their game. Each one of them faces a crisis, and rather than looking to God, they try to go it alone, with predictable outcomes. And as I said, for me, these accounts give me a window into myself. I see my own humanity in these people, and I recognize my own shortcomings and failures. But there's more. Like I said, God loves Aaron. God has a plan of salvation for all of his creation. That includes you and me. God has a plan to save us and to work in and through us to bring his love and salvation to others. Our failings, our brokenness, our weaknesses and doubts, our feelings of guilt and shame, God knows all about them. And with all that God knows about us, he's not deterred. His plans and purposes remain, and nothing we can do or not do can change that. What's more, amazingly, God is able to use even our failings to bring about his purposes. I don't like to accept that as readily, but it's true. As we read Scripture, what we see is God's plan of salvation unfolding. To begin with, God makes all things and he calls them good. Everything is the way God made it. And then in a moment of temptation and self-interest, all of that changes as Adam and Eve disobey God in a way that has echoed through the rest of history and can still be witnessed today. And fast forward to today, and that brokenness continues to affect us. When confronted with my own wrongdoing, even if it's something simple, I still feel that instinct to defend myself and find somewhere else to focus the blame. It's a struggle. I try to resist that urge. I know it's always best to own my part in any wrongdoing and to work to make amends. But it's not always easy. See, the thing is, we weren't made for wrongdoing. It's not called wrong just because God says so. I think we come to a place where too many of us simply don't understand why God gave the commandments he did. Each one of God's commandments, every single one of them, are there because when we violate any of them, we're hurting others in the order God created in order to benefit ourselves. We were not designed to live that way. Have you ever tried to use a screwdriver to drive a nail? Or, you know those little can openers with the triangle on the end that you use to open up a spout in the apple juice can? Hopefully some of you know what I'm talking about. Have you ever tried to use one of those, let's say, to open a soup can? It's frustrating and dangerous because it's not what those tools were designed for. It can be done, but it's really hard and dangerous. Our society talks of self-determination as hard work to become who we want to be, and I get that. Goals and dreams are good things and can help us grow into greatness even. But self-determination left unchecked can lead to a lot of brokenness or hurt if that self-determination is working against who God created us to be. Like all of us, Aaron was created by God for a purpose. First and always, he is a beloved child, created and loved by God. That is always our identity. Don't mistake that. We need to be really clear. Each one of us are a beloved child of God. Second, by selecting Aaron to be Moses' spokesperson, another word for that could be prophet, one who brings a message from God. But by selecting Aaron, God is moving Aaron toward becoming the person he was created to be, Israel's first priest and the father of the Levites who would serve God and the people for centuries. When Aaron is confronted by the people while Moses is up on the mountain, it looks to me like Aaron thinks it would be best to try to figure out what Moses might do and do that. After all, Aaron's been walking with Moses for decades. They know each other well. They've been through some crazy things together. And God's presence has gone with them. The people listen to Moses, even though they seem to grumble about everything. And so you can understand why Aaron starts to wonder, what would Moses do? But Aaron isn't Moses. He's not meant to be. Aaron is created for something different. And I have to wonder, what would have happened in this moment while Aaron was in charge if he had chosen a priestly prophetic response in keeping with his calling? Now, I don't know how much of his calling was clear to him at this point, but it's coming. And I just wonder what would have happened. Instead of trying to do what Moses would do, and really, who knows what Moses would have done, what if Aaron leaned into who he was? Rather than simply pacifying the people with what he thought they wanted. We don't know. What we do know is that all sin has consequences. Sin opposes the purposes of God and therefore always causes brokenness and hurt. Yet amazingly, Aaron's story is not over. In spite of all that's happened, Aaron still finds himself and his descendants in their role as Israel's priests, serving God and the people. Each of the heroes in Scripture, and their sidekicks too, live in a world where sin exists. Each one must be formed and led by God, just as we need to be. They make mistakes, huge and small. None of them know they're in the Bible. It's not as if they're like, oh right, we're at Exodus chapter whatever. They don't know. They're just like us. They succumb to temptations and fears, but none of this, none of it, disqualifies them from becoming who God made them to be. Moses and Aaron, they don't get to enter the promised land. That might be a topic for another Sunday, but sin has consequences. Still, God uses them to lead his people there. And that's a wonderful legacy. Through them, God is forwarding his plan of salvation. Aaron still becomes priest. The people of Israel, in spite of their grumbling and unfaithfulness, still become the nation through whom God will bless and reconcile the world to himself. In fact, remember John the Baptist, arguably another sidekick in Scripture? His family are direct descendants of Aaron. In spite of Aaron's shortcomings and choices, God brings about the one who will prepare the way for Jesus himself. Our sins, our self-interested choices are never more powerful than God's will. Our identity as beloved children of God is not something we can change. Another way to say that is when we reject God, God does not reject us. Of course, it isn't that our sin doesn't matter. Scripture makes clear how much damage sin causes to us and others and our relationship with God. It's just that sin cannot derail what God's going to do. We just don't have that kind of power. It's good and it honors God when we try to discern His will. Living in relationship with Him, doing what we're created for, that's who He made us to be. Neither Aaron's shortcomings and sins, nor Moses's, nor anyone else in all of history have altered God's plan in any way. God continues His work of restoring all things to Himself, even today. All things. That includes you and me as His beloved children. Ultimately, through His chosen people, God has given His only Son, Jesus Christ, whose sacrifice, death, and resurrection have defeated the power of sin. We are free. Now, contrary to what we might think, true freedom isn't permission to do whatever we feel like. Scripture and human history make it clear that that never ends well. A friend of mine recently realized that as an adult, he can eat chocolate cake anytime he wants. I also think he realized it's not always a good idea to eat chocolate cake anytime he wants. In Christ, we're truly free to become who we were created to be. We don't have to do what the world wants us to do or go it alone like Aaron chose to do in our text. We worship and serve a mighty, holy God, the one who made all things and who loves each one of us as His children. Will we get it wrong? Will we face temptations and trials? Sure. But just like He was with Aaron and Moses, and with Elsie, as we heard last week, as she served in Naaman's household, God will be with us, loving us, correcting us, and guiding us, if we will only seek Him and follow Him. We are free to find our intended place in His family, to belong, to be loved. God has shown us the way in Jesus. He's shown us through His word that He will never forsake us. Friends, in Christ we are free to truly live the way we were designed to live, loved as children of God. If God never gave up on Aaron, He's not about to give up on any of us. We are loved and we are free. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank You for Your word. Thank You for the story of Your people and how in it we see ourselves sometimes, our own shortcomings and our own inability to just trust You sometimes. But Lord, thank You that You are faithful, that even when we reject You, You do not reject us. Thank You for Aaron's story, that even through this huge mistake of his, this very unwise decision, this sin, You continued to love him and lead him. You disciplined him, and through him, You blessed all of humanity. Through his descendants, we have the stories of the Levites and the priests of Israel. We have emerging from that John the Baptist who prepared the way for Your Son Jesus, and we are thankful, Lord. And so I pray today, as we've heard Your word, as we've listened to Aaron's story, I pray that You've been at work in our hearts. Lord, I know You've been at work in mine as I prepared for this message. Help us to hear how much You love us and how there is nothing we could do to make us outside of that love. Instead, Lord, correct us and show us what it is You've made us to do and who You've made us to be. Beloved children, partnering with You in sharing Your love with everybody around us who will listen. And Lord, I ask all of this and that You will have all of the glory, honor, and praise. We ask this in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, for His sake. Amen.
Well, Pastor Tyler, thank you so much for bringing God's word to us this morning and reminding us that we are free to be who He intended us to be, and free to live that life that He's given us. I'd like to respond to that in song by singing, "Look What You've Done For Me. Your Blood Has Set Me Free." Let's sing together.
Look what you've done for me. Your blood has set me free. Jesus, my Lord, look what you've done for me. Oh, I haven't been the same ever since that day I called your name. Yahweh, Yahweh, look what you've done for me. What can I do for you, my Lord? I want you to know my heart is yours. It's not a question of what you can do for me, but what can I do for you? My Lord, up to your cross I crawl, but now I'm standing 10 feet tall. Jesus, my Savior, look what you've done for me. Oh, I'm free, at last I'm free. I owe you my life completely. Yahweh, Yahweh, look what you've done for me. Oh, what can I do for you, my Lord? I want you to know my heart is yours. It's not a question of what for me, but what can I do for you, my Lord? Oh, what can I do for you, my Lord? I want you to know my heart is yours. It's not a question of what you can do for me, but what can I do for you, my Lord? What can I do for you, my Lord? What can I do for you?
Indeed, look what he's done for us. It's not a question of what God can do for us, but we can do for him. And so just be encouraged this week as we come close to the close of our service here this morning. Just remember that God has given us a new life. He's given us a new day, and we get to look at life a whole new way. So let's sing one more song together. It's a new day.
Each new morning brings new blessings as the sun begins to shine, and the glory of our God is shown in majesty. It's the new life that he's giving in every breath we breathe. It's the miracle of new creation at work inside of you. It's a new day. It's a new chance for us to see the beauty around. It's a new day. It's a new chance for us to make a joyful sound. It's a new
new purpose as the Spirit leads us through. And the glory of our God is shown all along the way. It's the new hope that is holy, and it's hope that will remain. It's the miracle of heaven that He's prepared for that glorious day. It's a new day. It's a new chance for us to see the beauty around. It's a new day. It's a new chance for us to make a joyful sound. It's a new day. It's a new song so you and I can dance and sing. It's a new day for us to worship the King.
So in this brief little series, we've examined two individuals who serve as sidekicks of a sort as part of God's work in the world. We've seen that when we follow where God's leading, He's faithful to provide everything and exactly what we need to follow Him. We've seen that God loves us. He loves us enough to include us in the work that He's doing. Even though He truly doesn't need our help, even though our participation sometimes makes things perhaps unnecessarily messy, God still loves us and wants to include us. We've also seen that God loves us enough not to place the burden of the outcome on our shoulders. God alone is responsible. Our role is to follow, participate, and reflect this incredible love to our world and anyone who will listen. So as we close, hear Paul's words to the believers in Rome with a couple of bits added by me, if that's okay. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, not even our own shortcomings and missteps, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Have a great week. Go in peace.
Shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. I
favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. Beside you, all around you, and within you, he is with you.
You're rejoiced. He is for. May the faith.